Kate DiCamillo says she was the shyest child in the world, the kind of kid who wouldn't say boo to a goose. Well, she found her voice as a writer of stories for young people. Among her best-selling books are Because of Winn-Dixie, the recent Flora and Ulysses, and the Newbery Award-winning Tale of Despereaux. She'll spend the next 2 years as both author and ambassador for stories and reading. Kate DiCamillo lives in Minneapolis and joins us from there. And congratulations to you, and it's nice to talk to you again.
Well, thank you very much for being willing to talk to me.
So the shyest child in the world becomes a national ambassador. How did that happen?
Well, I know there's a really rich irony in that, isn't there? And I'm not exaggerating. Well, I do tend to exaggerate. I'm a storyteller. But really, I was just like, if I had a dime for every time an adult said, "Cat got your tongue," you know. And my mother was a very outgoing person, and she could never believe that I couldn't run into the store and ask somebody some kind of question. So how did I end up here? I ended up here by telling stories, and telling stories helped me connect with the world, and it turned me into somebody who can talk to people, I think. I don't know. I'm doing a pretty good job talking to you, right?
You are. Well, so tell us how you see this role and what you plan. Do you start off thinking that there's a problem that you need to address, a problem of young people in reading?
I want to remind people, I don't want to think about it as a problem. I want to remind people of the great and profound joy that can be found in stories, and that stories can connect us to each other, and that reading together changes everybody involved. So I'm not coming at it from a problem angle. I'm coming at it from a celebration angle. That's how I would like to think of it.
What books did that for you, brought you out of the shell you were talking about?
Well, one of them, and I was a kid who loved to read, and also a kid who was lucky enough to I had a mom that read to me all the time. Island of the Blue Dolphins by Scott Odell had a huge impact on me. Harriet the Spy, Louise Fitzhugh. I remember my mother reading me Beverly Cleary's Ribsy. All of those books kind of did that thing of connecting me to myself and connecting me to the world and connecting me to the people around me. So that's kind of the message that I want to carry out into the world. That's what I hope to do.
And do you think of, is reading reading, or does it matter what young people are reading? I'm thinking about some of the books that gain tremendous currency, like The Hunger Games now and other ones you can think of at different times. Do you think just whatever they're reading is good, or do you think there certain things are more nourishing than others?
Well, I'm not going to make judgments about what people are reading. I just want them to be reading, and I think reading one book leads to another book, so I'm just going to celebrate the whole ball of wax. I also want people to know that this is, you know, that kids' books can be for adults as well. There are a lot of different ways to connect to a story. And I think Harry Potter has actually gone a long way to convincing people that adults can read kid books. But I'd like to just bring more people into the room.
The other thing that becomes part of this conversation, of course, these days is technology and the sort of competition for young people's attention. Do you think of all these things, whether it's video games or tablets, do you think of them as the enemy, or is there a way to make them friends? How do you think about it?
I think that it's a matter of balance and moderation, and I think that my role here is just to remind everybody of the power of story, and it can be just as entertaining and engaging as a video game. So again, I'm not going to say, no, don't do that, but rather remember story. And story is what makes us human in a way. So I'm here to say story can be a powerful thing.
I remember when we first talked, and now it's 10 years ago when you won the Newbery Award, but you came to writing late yourself, right? This was not, you weren't a natural. You just sort of came into it.
No, I'm not a natural. I'm a late bloomer. And I feel so fortunate to have ended up where I've ended up as somebody who gets to tell stories for a living. But I didn't start writing until I was almost 30 years old. And I didn't get published until I was 36 or 37. So, but it was something that I always knew that I wanted to do. And I finally sat down and started trying to do it. So, hey, let's hear it for all the late bloomers and for dreams coming true, right?
And I think I read that, this is a little hard for me to believe, but maybe you can tell me, you received 450 rejection letters before anyone agreed to publish you?
I wish that I could tell you that that is erroneous, but it is not. I kept a notebook where I kept track of everything, where I sent it, when it came back. So that is the case. So I sent stories out for 6 years before anything happened. And I, when I go and I talk to kids, I go, imagine if I had given up at like the at the rejection letter, you know, at the 200, I wouldn't be here. So if there's any message that I can give in that respect, it's, you know, persistence and not giving up on your dream.
All right. Well, Kate DiCamillo, congratulations again and good luck in your new role, the National Ambassador for Young People's Literature. Thanks so much.
Thank you.